So we'll get started in a couple of minutes. I always just kind of like to get a sense of the crowd before I go through my my quick spiel. So any exhibit or event sort of designers in today's session? Awesome. Any of you familiar with or know or been to the Philadelphia Flower Show? Just one or two, a couple? Okay. So today's presentation that I'm going to give you is really a case study in some of the work that I've been involved in for the Philadelphia Flower Show. It's an exhibit that goes on every year, and I'm going to show you how we basically started from SketchUp with just hand sketches and brought that all the way through into documentation as well as in photorealistic renderings, and kind of give you a look at sort of my workflow and how I kind of approach such a large scale and complicated project. So first, my name is Daniel Brown. I've been teaching SketchUp for over 10 years now. My background's in architecture, and actually, after graduating from architecture school, I started working for Google as a SketchUp trainer. Basically giving workshops, smaller capacity than what we have here at Basecamp. After my contract with Google, I started SketchUpTrainer.com. And based in Philadelphia, I offer two-day SketchUp workshops up and down the East Coast, as well as in other cities and locations. Certainly do private trainings, company trainings, and then do a lot of consulting work as well. So when I'm not traveling and training, I'm typically working on some kind of architecture or interior design project. And then over the last couple years, I got involved with the Philadelphia Flower Show and in designing some of their sort of exhibit and event sort of designs here. So you can check out my website after this, SketchUpTrainer.com. Again, I do a lot of training, a lot of tutorials and such. But really, what I want to focus on today is kind of looking at how to use SketchUp to create a large scale exhibit. So here, again, I'm going to show you sort of the workflow that I went through for developing the entrance garden to the Philadelphia Flower Show for last year. So for those of you that don't know, the Philadelphia Flower Show is it's produced by the Pennsylvania Horticulture Society. It's been going on for a very long time, since 1829. It's the largest world sort of flower show, and for an event that covers 10 days, you have about 250,000 people that walk through this exhibit. So there's just a lot of traffic, a lot of people going through, and sort of my task was to basically create the entrance that kind of sets the theme for every show. So in previous years, I would be involved sort of at the end of the design phase. So this was Hawaii in 2012, done in SketchUp, using LightUp as a photorealistic animation tool at the time. So my role in these earlier years was really limited. I would basically take the model that PHS and Gary Radin, who's usually the head designer for the entrance garden, I would take those designs and just kind of bring it to life, right? They designed it a little bit in SketchUp, and then I would kind of polish it a little bit more. So 2 years ago for Holland, you know, a lot of tulips, a lot of sort of elements here. This was rendered in Podium. So you'll see how even each year I go through different workflows. So 5 years ago, I used LightUp. 2 years ago, I used Podium, and then you'll see for this year or this past year's show, I used actually SketchFX, and it really just depend on the scale and size of the project that we were working on. And I'll play this real quick. Has anybody seen this video that SketchUp put on YouTube? This will give you a sense of the show, so I'll let this play for a couple minutes.
Do a different theme for the Philadelphia Flower Show. This is our 189th show, believe it or not. We've been going on since 1829. We have 250,000 people that come to the show. So it's over 25,000 people a day. This year's theme is Wonders of Water. So we're really interpreting the theme in a lot of different ways. We spend so much time working on the entrance garden. It's really the thing that interprets the theme the biggest and the most, and it has the biggest wow factor. We want people, when they walk in the door, set that tone and set the stage for the rest of their experience.
Working on the entrance garden is kind of an amazing opportunity. There's so many people that walk through the space, and just really planning out in SketchUp on how, you know, we can anticipate different places that people will walk through and different sort of ways to immerse them right into the model.
One of the really significant differences in the show design this year is that we've changed the way visitors experience the immediate entrance into the show. This year we wanted people to get, you know, enveloped and experience something all around them.
Being in the immersive environment really allowed us to know where the canopy was and kind of project where that first moment was, where you sort of walk in. It's kind of amazing.
So an important part of our process.
So this video goes on, it goes on a couple more minutes, but I'd rather certainly show you more of the fun tricks. You can watch that. That was a video that SketchUp actually created last year showcasing the show. So you can find that on SketchUp's YouTube channel to finish watching that. There's also another video on it as well. But really what I want to kind of focus on is how did we get to that point? There was a lot of work going on in so many different facets, so many different industries, from architecture, landscape and floral, to the set and sort of exhibit design, all sort of compiling together. And that really just kind of started from the initial sketch. And each show is a little bit different. So we always kind of begin drawing with some kind of design inspiration. This year, it being the theme of wonders of water, we were looking at design inspiration for these bamboo sort of structures, some kind of bridge, and then obviously elements of rain, whether it's fog or waterfalls or sort of rain screens and so on. So, you know, the process really begins at that hand sketch, and for me, it's very difficult. I want to get into SketchUp as soon as possible, but don't forget about this sort of lost art of drawing by hand, because it does drive a lot of this. So early on, Gary and Sam would kind of look at a lot of little sketches like this. So this is like one iteration of maybe five or six. So you can see there's some, you know, suggestive ideas of some kind of tower, some kind of waterfall, and some kind of bridge. But to really kind of understand how that all fits into this space, you have to realize that the conference is huge. It's, you know, 840 feet by 400 feet. But our focus, our goal, is really just on that entrance garden. So everyone is coming through literally that entrance there. Nobody usually goes through any of the other entrances because this is the driving factor that showcases everything else within the show. So everything I'm going to show you today is really in that 15,000 square foot sort of space. It's in this sort of 120 feet by 130 feet sort of column grid. And to pack into that, we had all these sort of criteria or elements from our inspiration that we needed to put in here. So the waterfall garden, the suspension bridge, the rainfall garden, and so on. So those hand sketches would be really, really basic and crude at this point, but they were suggestive in sort of, you know, the workflow and circulation that we needed to achieve and how we wanted people to experience the space. So I always, throughout this whole process, we were always not just thinking in plan here, but we really needed to kind of think about what the experience is going to be in several different sort of directions. So we kind of landed on this floor plan for several reasons, but mainly it's because it provided an opportunity for people to kind of meander and spread from the main entrance. But then, which is a little bit more challenging to deal with, we had to deal with everybody coming back. So usually when I go through an exhibit like this, you know, you want to start and end in the same place. So we have all the visitor experiences of everyone kind of meeting back at the entrance so that, you know, they could leave and whatnot. So, or sort of see the entrance again. So we're trying to factor this in. And early on in SketchUp, we're really trying to orbit and navigate to kind of feel what it's going to be like in all of those angles. So the biggest tip early on from that hand sketch is to stay organized really, really early. So those floor beds, those floral beds that I showed, right away I'm making those as components, because those are little areas that I'm going to then change or maybe save out as their own files sort of later on. So you can see here's kind of that sketch, and really basic, just the CAD plan on the ground, some of the floral beds. It's not highly detailed. You can see like the water's in really just kind of like an oval shape. There's no terrain yet to kind of set height. But even early on here, I'm using layers, I'm using components. That way, as we layer in more information, it's seamless in how this thing is gonna change and sort of move. So you can see here, further developed, the model has a lot more floral elements, a lot more palm trees. We're starting to get some suggestions of what type of floral arrangements we're gonna do, but nothing finalized just yet. We're doing some kind of suggestion for the bamboo structures, but it's very block-like. It's just massing, because this is gonna change. This is really loose and flexible at this point here. And also, because I'm creating everything as components, you can see we weren't completely sold on option B just yet. So we actually really had to design both to finalize and make sure that how we were driving the walkway through this was gonna work. And even from option B here, this actually switched. So this is the configuration we ended up using, but the waterfall we pushed back to here and we brought the rain fall forward. So it's kind of like a hybrid of the two. So when you think you're down that path and sort of figure it all out, until you really kind of navigate around and be inside of that environment, it helped us kind of make cues and decisions on what to do. So here's more of what the sort of final layout would be. And again, using layers, I'm able to turn a lot of things off. And then more importantly, in these bamboo sort of canopy structures, these are just blocks. So you can kind of see it's kind of like a piece of Legos or Lincoln log kind of towering elements. I'm just using a texture, just a PNG image that has sort of a bamboo piece on one side and a bamboo piece on another and some middle bracing just to suggest that it's bamboo. And it was enough to convince PHS and sort of everyone that needed to sign off on this of where we're being suggestive, but knowing that, this is the look and style of SketchUp at this moment. We know we're gonna get more detailed and more layered on information as you're adding more stuff above and adding more floral to it. So a lot of times a good tip here is sort of know what your deliverable is for that sort of moment. So don't try to overcomplicate what needs to be sort of sold at this point. So the floral doesn't need to be sold right now. The overhead canopies don't, but the position of these bamboo structures really do, because that's the driving force for the budget. So if we can set those first, then everything else can kind of fall into place. So here now, that basic rectangular sort of box structure is now basically scrapped or deleted because we needed something that was more modular. So if you look at these four towers up front, they're literally the same component that's just reversed or mirrored. And for construction and for a project that's only going up for 10 days, we needed something that was quick and easy to kind of build. So everything that I'm creating here is a component within a component within a component. That way, if I'm changing or extending the sort of lengths of the sort of top stands, I can do that once. And I don't have to do it 25 or 30 times for each individual object. The other important thing is, because these are all components, as I'm adding detail, it allows me to add quantity data. So if you right click on any component and go to entity info, you can get a quantity spec of all the components in that model. So it's a quick way that you can quantify that. But again, it's very, even in that exercise, it's very easy to kind of go down a rabbit hole of just focusing in on the level of detail of the bamboo structures. Constantly, we had to go back and just kind of play the little scenes or the three or four scenes of what that experience is going to be. Because otherwise, we were just designing stuff that like was kind of irrelevant or sort of out of the sort of main view. So this scene that you're seeing here was really always a reminder of, okay, we're getting people through the canopy structure to the bridge, and then we really want them to kind of turn and open up into this 25-foot waterfall effect here. So constantly I'm using scenes in SketchUp, or if any of you have used the 3D connection mouse, somebody know, or joystick, I should say, that was really great on this project because you can smoothly kind of move in and out of really complicated geometry here. So as you can see, the plants and the vegetation in this model are a big driving force of this. And I am not any plant expert at all. When PHS and Gary came to me, they're giving me a list that looks something like this. Yeah, and it was this like Excel sheet of, you know, words I can't pronounce and Latin this and that. But, you know, Google's a wonderful thing. So from here, I can't just go on the 3D warehouse and find all of these specific trees. So really, there was probably a good week worth of work of just downloading and compiling every sort of stock image that we could possibly find. And not to go into detail up to this, but this is basically just a Photoshop trick of cutting out several sort of hundred images and saving them as PNG textures. Because in SketchUp, if you save an image as a PNG, you can remove the background of it. So all the tree elements that you see in the models that I'm showing are all just 2D face me components. So face me components is a way to make it look 3D because it's always just kind of facing the camera for you. So it's important to note that using face me components work great in perspective, but not great in plan. So at no point were we trying to create a plan drawing from our SketchUp model. So we knew that going in, that wasn't part of our sort of scope, but we still need to identify where things were gonna go. So this kind of, you know, hand loosely done sort of planting ahead, as I refer to it, was able to kind of drive where some of those positions were. For me, to organize all of these and really to kind of, every time I'm in a meeting and they're talking about a Robellini or a, you know, whatever was this orchid tree, I had no idea what they were describing. So what I typically will do is I'll take that SketchUp model and basically just create a plant library model of one file. This way, if you name the component correctly, so when you right click and make an object a component and name it, when you use the label tool in SketchUp, the default text for that label is the definition or the name of the component. So I didn't have to, I just have to type this in once and all these labels would then appear with the right sort of name. From there, you could, because I'm working on a Mac, and you could do this on a PC as well, but I would have two monitors up, one of the plant library and the other one of the master sort of model. So you could basically select that floral element, copy it, so just simple Control C or Command C on a Mac. But even so, before I'm copying it, I'm also making sure, again, my layers are kind of organized because I want it on a floral layer that I can then turn off once I'm in this big, what I'll refer to as the master model. So then in this master model, all I have to do is make sure I'm in that group or in that component, and then just Command V. So I find this much easier than trying to go to file import and sort of fetch wherever that file is. And it certainly, I didn't want I didn't want 100 SketchUp models of every single individual tree. So even for next year's show, if we're using some of these same plant elements, rather than going into this file, I'll just go into that plant library, because even if it's something that's suggestive of a color or arrangement, we have that sort of stock library to kind of pull from for another model. Which again leads to a little bit of just making sure you're using layers effectively within that SketchUp model. So in something like this, not only am I separating the objects out as separate components, but I'm also being able to turn those objects off with using layers. So in something like this, I'll start with kind of the landscape bed as one whole big component. That way, you saw early on, it was very sort of flat and just kind of rigid. I could basically scrap that and draw a nice smooth one, like you see here, and then layer in all the information on top of that. So for design intent, for the fabrication drawings, this is all we needed for ground cover. But then once we got into the marketing renderings that you'll see at the end of this presentation, this whole layer basically got scrapped. It got basically deleted because these were just placeholders for the specific color and elements that we needed eventually. So if I can control that in layers as well as a separate component, it makes it easier to modify it sort of later on. Same thing with the trees. If you remember that list earlier before, you know, this has a budget. So we had to make sure we were using so many traveler's palms or bamboo elements. So at any point, we could select on any one of those components and get a quantity take, as I mentioned earlier before. And then certainly for the waterfall structure, being able to have it as its own component, I could save it out as its own file and work on it and not be with inside this sort of heavy model. Because this model's, I think, like 3 million polygons or faces and edges. So it's a lot to work in for a little laptop like this 5-year-old MacBook Pro here. But once all the layering, once all that information is sort of detailed, we now have to create that as some kind of document that we're going to push into layout. In years past, the workflow typically was taking that SketchUp model and then bringing it into Vectorworks or bringing it into AutoCAD to then design intent or design document. What was kind of new this year, and which was a challenge for me, was how to really properly take this in layout. And that way, we can just keep and drive everything in SketchUp, make changes, and then have it sync with the layout document. So my biggest tip when you're going from SketchUp to layout is to storyboard as soon as possible. So I don't know, there's so much time that was wasted in, or that can be wasted in just kind of trying to set the scene on the right page and sort of being in that sort of paper space. A lot of times what we'll do is we'll literally just print out, you know, this sort of chicken scratch of notes so that we have sort of a red line in pen and paper, and then that way we know sort of what to put. Also, from a collaborative standpoint, this was really my first documentation of the show. So I didn't know the language, didn't know the notes, didn't know sort of the technical details as much as Gary Radin does, who designs this every year. So as we were collaborating on this, I was basically starting and driving the layout document while we were doing sort of screenshots or prints so that he could mark up and note, which was much easier than you know, trying to kind of do this sometimes like over the shoulder or you know, just try to, for me sometimes, is trying to make sort of guesses. So in a page like this, you know, I knew technical drawing wise we needed a top view, a front view, a side view, and so on. But setting up that storyboard, it gave Gary then the ability or the flexibility to add the notes and the details and call outs so that we can adjust the drawing. And especially too, if you've been in layout, you know that sort of moving objects, moving the viewport and moving notes at the same time is really tricky. You have to kind of like group your object. So we were trying to avoid having to shift our storyboard or shift our pages. So in something like this, I know, like, all right, you know, there's going to be a lot of notes here. I might have to begin to kind of nudge this over. So it gave cues as far as sort of where we needed to position things. And you can see that kind of was clear in this sort of final page for this detail on how to build this suspension bridge. But in addition to that, one other thing that I really like and try to do, and this might just be kind of the slight OCD or the slight, I always like to have grids and guides. So I actually create a layer in layout that's just a grid layer. So I literally draw rectangles that set my sort of nine columns and nine rows, or whatever that sort of breakup needs to be. And then, like any technical drawing, one thing I learned a long time ago is when you do typical technical drawings, you usually start with your top view in the top left, your front view in the bottom left, your right side view on the right, and then your ISO view. That's a basic technical drawing for a page layout. I'll thank my high school tech ed teacher for that. And then from there, you're trying to dimension out to the sides. That way, you can then note on the inside. So for me, this technique is my driving factor every time I'm creating a technical drawing. Now, there are ways, you know, you might have to sort of break from that. But generally speaking, I always try to sort of do this because this is obviously the fastest and easiest way to communicate technical drawing elements. So you can see the thing that changed in this one was instead of doing a side view, the beauty of using SketchUp is it's 3D. So rather than doing a side view that only shows something in 2D, we ended up sort of making that side view more of a exploded sort of detail there so that you could see where the kick plate or the baseboard was attaching and the structural pieces as well sort of came together. And there you can see that sort of grid. So this is a layer that I put and just kind of turn off after I'm done using it. But I can snap to this layer. So it's just literally rectangles that are moving copied in layout. And then they're set to an opacity so that they can kind of turn on and off there. And you'll see I'm really I try to stay organized with where my labels and notes go because there's nothing worse than putting a drawing together and just having, you know, five fonts and sort of text and notes all over the place. So try to always simplify this as much as possible. Remember, the person, the fabricators bidding this have never seen this before. So we're trying to communicate it in a clear, sort of concise way so that there's no questions, because if something's wrong, we don't have time to rebuild it. It's only a 10-day show, and they start building this sort of weeks out in advance. So there's not much room for error in sort of losing that detail. So that's where layers in layout also become pretty effective. I try not to use many layers in layout, but generally speaking, I'll have my title block, which is my master layer. I'll have that guide layer that you saw, that yellow sort of guide or grid. And then I put all the SketchUp viewports on a viewport layer. And then typically, depending on the detail of the drawing, I might have a drawing elements layer and then a separate notes and dimensions. So here we can see the viewports within that space. And then from there, it's subtle to see on screen here, but there's some things that you don't want to draw in SketchUp that you only need for a specific view. So you literally have to take the line tool or the rectangle tools inside of layout to draw those. Usually for me in layout, that means the line weights for sort of establishing a ground plane. And then for here, we did a dotted blue line to kind of represent the waterfalls sort of falling down. The other thing as well, the line work for the shelves where they would put then container plants on top, we just needed to dash those. So in order to do that, we actually turned the shelves on, drew them in layout, and then turned the shelves off in that viewport. Otherwise, it's going to be just a solid line when it's viewing in layout.
Sorry, say that one more time.
Yep. So for this piece here, you basically make it visible in SketchUp first. Draw it with layout. So actually, I think I'm on the page, so I can show it quick. I'll go back one because it has it there. So imagine this shelf I want to show as a dashed element. I'll literally draw this on the drawing layer, first tip. Don't draw in the notes layer. So I'll take this rectangle tool, draw it like that, and then move and copy it or sort of draw another one. And then in layout, I would just hide these options so that when they do hide, they're going to just leave that line right there below.
What about the dimensions?
The dimension, so if you do, so we didn't have to dimension, so the beauty of this is we didn't have to dimension the spacing of that. But if it does, so if I draw this and it snaps, see how that end point there? If it is snapping to the SketchUp model, then your dimensions are going to be accurate. So when you go to dimension that, you don't. When you dimension this, you can. So it's going to try to dimension to the scale that the SketchUp model is. But because this is drawn not to the scale of the SketchUp model, but it's drawn. Let me just delete that real quick. Because this is drawn to the scale. It's you're in paper space now, so that's drawing 1 inch in paper size. So what you can do here is don't auto scale it, force it to be 3/8 of an inch or whatever the drawing scale was, and then you get your right dimensions. So after the dimension layer there, I also will do again just sort of a note layer there. So from here, I'm going to demo this little part here. This is what I call master modeling. So as you can imagine, this file is a pretty extensive and sort of large file. So be aware that you don't need to draw everything in one file to document it in layout. So if you're doing something like this, even this file here, this is three separate SketchUp files. So one file has the entire waterfall, which would be these viewports. Another file has just this one, and then the plank itself is its own SketchUp file. So when creating the waterfall in this trowel here, let me just delete this for a second. A little trick that I like to do is I'll open up that waterfall model, which is this one here. And you can see I have all scenes that aren't part of the sort of master file. They're all scenes within this own component here. So if I'm trying to document just for that page, these scenes that you're seeing here help driving what those viewports are going to be in the layout document. So there I needed it sort of on, but then I needed to kind of turn it off to kind of show some of the elements. But a little trick is you can copy any SketchUp group or component. So let's say you have a drawing, it's quick, you don't have to make changes to it a lot. You can basically take this component and copy it. So I'm just going to go to Edit Copy or Command C on a Mac. And then in Layout, I'm going to go to Edit and click Paste. So it copies from your clipboard the model and basically does like a file insert, like you would insert any viewport or any SketchUp component. And the beauty of this is now its own file, and it's basically just the object within the SketchUp model. So the benefit, well, one thing I need to do first is select a flat one so that when I dimension this, there we go. It'll do true north. I don't want it angled. So when you copy this, what I can do now is in my SketchUp model toolbar here, I'll change the style so that it's hidden line, which is just the black and white version of it. I'll set it to ortho, which it is right now, but I want to set that top view first. And then the scale I want is 3/8 of an inch equals a foot. So then I can scale the viewport down like that, zoom in a little bit, and then as we did before, we got our top view. I'm going to hold down Option, copy that down, if you actually hold down shift, it's keeping that aligned too. So I can make this the front view. Pull that up a little bit. Copy that over. Whoops. Over to here. Set that to the right. And bring that back up. Expand it a little bit because we got to make room for the ISO. So from there, once I have that, then like before, it now gives you a nice, clean, concise sort of area that you can dimension and sort of note. Another good little tip for this is this component or this group doesn't exist as its own file anywhere but the layout document. So what's really interesting with layout is if you've noticed, it always creates a really large file, typically the same size, if not larger, than your existing SketchUp model. So there's a reason for that. One is when you open layout every time, it tries to find wherever this file is sort of sent or referenced to. So it's always trying to find that document. So you can see I'm sort of missing some documents here. The beauty of this, though, is let's say in InDesign or Illustrator that you lose that linked file, or even AutoCAD. If you lose that XREF, it doesn't show, right? In layout, it does. So that file not only is linked, but it's also embedded as a sort of temporary file in here. So let's say for some reason I accidentally delete this SketchUp file. I can actually recover it because I have a version of it in this layout document. So I can right click on any viewport and open this back in SketchUp, and it's gonna open it and just basically ask you to then save it. So this actually saved me a couple times where I was moving stuff from Dropbox over to another folder and then just kind of lost it. But we had sort of a layout document sort of created, so I can always right click and open that directly from that layout document. It's also beneficial too if you're working on this, but then the server or hard drive that somebody else that you're collaborating with doesn't have those same files, it's still gonna load in layout and they're still gonna see all the information within that file. So again, I'm constantly I'm never modeling typically in this master file, because one other sort of tip for this, let me go back to a bird's eye view here, is in order to create this waterfall document, what I'll typically do is save this in this file here. You never want to work on it in the master and save down. Because if I worked on something in this master file and right-clicked on this component and saved it as the waterfall file, I lose the scenes that I established when it's its own file. And this happened to me on this project, which is why I explain this. So if you're ever working in this scenario where you're trying to kind of parse out the model, always work from the smallest piece up. So if I need to make a change to this piece here, I'm gonna make it in the waterfall model. I'm gonna save that waterfall model, close out of it, and here in the master model, I'll re-link it or reload it. It really should just, the terminology should really just be called replace, because it's not a linked file. But be aware that you can reload any SketchUp component with any other option or any other file.
Is that always manual?
There is a way. Enteroth References Manager is an extension. It's a $50 extension that will actually relink and set path directories for it, yeah. So you could use an extension like that to have it sort of link. So a prime example of it was if you had like a low poly version and then a high poly version, you could actually relink the entire folder and then it finds every file within that folder. It's a pretty cool extension. For me, I don't do this that much. I really only do this reloading for these really large files. So And I like to make sure I'm the only one sort of controlling this. So I tend to always have it be a manual reload instead. Yeah?
For all of, you mentioned the waterfall is a component of itself, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So all the different like bamboo structures that you have, are those also components
of
that same thing?
Yep. So, it depends. Let me go back. So yes, so to build that bamboo canopy, this was all one big model. But then in this, we tried to make it a kit of parts as much as possible. So like these two drawings really don't make much sense. They were just trying to help us for height so people weren't grabbing plants and pulling them down. But from here, I would take, for example, this component in the master file, right-click and save it out as its own file. And then in that file, that would be the viewport or the page that I'm inserting to document this page. So if you look at this file in SketchUp, it's very simple. It's not the whole file there. It's just just that, basically. These are the subcomponents sort of within that, yep. So the only challenge that we would have is if this was a universal piece, which I think is what your question's getting at, yeah. So if this is a universal piece and you make a change here in this subcomponent, it's not going to affect the master. So there are times where I'll break that rule and work in the master, but a lot of times from there I'll copy and then paste in place in this document. As long as your origin points are the same, once you do a copy and paste in place, it will retain that component definition. So. In this particular file, I believe there were 10. Let's see if I have. So usually, there we go. So so in this very unorganized folder, that's partially my fault. I'm organized in some way and very disorganized in others. My wife will certainly attest to that. So in here, if I go in the shop build document, this parts document, those are all the sub components. So it was the waterfall, the landscape areas, some of the canopy elements, and some stuff got not sort of lost along the way, but we just did like copy paste as viewports, so we weren't changing it from there at any point after. And just to give you a sense, just while we're in sort of layout here. This is what the final shop build document sort of looked like. And again, it just followed that storyboard. So main page notes that were done in Word and copied and pasted in here. Overall plan, which was from the master model with a lot of layers turned off to just show the plant beds. Your scenes or perspective views of the model. Hidden line style of all the contours and all the terrain with notes. And then this became the start of the kit of parts for the tower. So the four main elements. Basically to create it, we had these like long scaffolding D trusses, which would be this one here. And we just kind of rotated and turned those elements based off of sort of where they are. So we had like a D1, D2, D3, D4. And then all the A, Bs, and sort of tower elements. That way, fabricators could just kind of, you know, have that sort of set. So some of the, like the B and C towers had this little like attachment within flora elements would go on that. Now I'll go through this a little bit more. So you can see it's very design intent. So that's kind of the beauty of this too, is it didn't have to be overly complicated. From this set, we will usually get questions back from vendors. So we, and in some cases, had to value engineer a lot of this. So when we're doing those value engineering, rather than kind of starting from scratch all over again, we're just updating the subcomponents and relinking it back into the master model. That way, all of our changes take effect. Like this floral bamboo pole, you know, we were starting with a smaller base and a smaller sort of plate, and based off of suggestions, we had to make that a little bit thicker, or for budget, you know, end up being like a 2-inch or 3-inch diameter bamboo pole just because of costs of those elements. So having everything sort of broken out, it gave us that flexibility to make those changes pretty seamless. So once those shop drawings get in and sort of are developed, so that document set, that's usually done like October, usually this time, September, October. So that gives 2 months then to actually create marketing renderings for an event then that's usually in March. So my biggest tip when you're creating photorealistic renderings, so anyone create photorealistic renderings in here? Sort of show hands. Okay, great. So my biggest tip is not only know your limits, know your computer limits as well. So the challenge that I had early on with creating these photorealistic renderings is the way that I wanted to approach it was using Podium, because that's what I'm just most accustomed to. It's what I've used since college, really. But the challenge with that is the limits and capabilities of not only the hard drive, but the file size and sort of complexity of the models here. There's so many PNG images, and to use Podium for this in comparison to what I did for Holland 2 years ago, it just wasn't going to work. So, and it would just take a lot of time to just create one still image. So these are all done, these renderings are all done using an extension called SketchFX, which is kind of like a Photoshop with ambient occlusion sort of put to it, right inside of SketchUp. So it's an extension you can purchase. I'll show you a couple more examples of it. Yeah, usually our documents are 11 by 17, so usually like 5,000 pixels wide is kind of like a safe choice. It's not great for 24 by 36 inch boards, but all of this is usually never going to be larger than 11 by 17 for what we were doing. There may be one image that we'll do higher, and then I'll just do the math, 300 dpi by, you know, 24 by 36. To get that higher resolution. But typically, if you stay in like the 3,000 to 5,000 pixels wide, it's going to be super high res. Even some of this stuff, we could go smaller just because it was just for print or just for web, social media. So a couple tricks that I'll finish with, and then I'll open up to some Q&A for the last 10 minutes. In creating these final renderings, you really want to kind of layer information as much as possible. That way, it's just gonna make a seamless sort of move into that rendering. So here's what the model looked like straight out of SketchUp. And the challenge with this, particularly working in an environment like this, is I never wanna see the rest of the convention center. So a lot of times I'll do like a gray ground or sort of a gray sky. But even here, a little trick that works really well is using fog in SketchUp. So if you click on window, click on fog, you can set where that sort of fog point is going to be. So this was really helpful in just kind of softening where that horizon line is, because regardless what you do, your eye is always going to be drawn to that column and that line. Whereas I want your eye to be drawn really to the floral elements here as much as possible. My next trick is place people in a way to hide your mistakes. Seriously, no joke. In addition to that, usually, and this model doesn't have it as much, but usually I try to place people sort of to hide and mask the horizon line, because you don't want to really kind of see past that. But then also too, like I'm using it usually to kind of drive where you want your eye to see. So if I go back a couple slides, you can see in these renderings, the people are really on the outside, and I'm trying to draw everybody sort of in. And you can see there's a lot of people sort of crowded over here. There's two reasons for that. One is I didn't want to detail this tower and the plants over here, and the horizon line's right there. So by kind of adding more people there, and I probably could have doubled the number of people in this model for what it realistically feels like when you walk through this during the sort of peak hours. You rarely ever have sort of an empty sort of space here. And just a lot of people taking selfies and all that fun stuff. So use people really to your advantage. The next tip is know what works and views better in, say, Photoshop than in SketchUp. So creating waterfall is not easy to do in any rendering application. So SketchFX and Podium is just not going to do it. So a lot of times what I'll do is, just for a sort of reminder or hint, this is just a green rectangle used as a green screen, just to be able to select a color area that in Photoshop I knew where to put that waterfall then. So it's basically just a layered export so that I can magic wand and select this area. So that way when I get to the waterfall, I have it just being in that location. From SketchUp, yeah. So I literally just drew a rectangle, put it up in the space on like how wide I thought the waterfall was going to be, and just made it, probably shouldn't have made it green because it's going to catch with other greens, but you can make it like, you know, whatever color. You could do a PNG or a JPEG as well. Yep. From there, here's what it looked like with SketchFX. So anyone use SketchFX? One or two. So without going into detail of it, you can find this online. It's an extension that will do like paint and watercolor effects in SketchUp, but then it also has a ambient occlusion option as well. So ambient occlusion is that natural sort of shading between objects. So it's not going to add reflection or lighting, but it's going to do ambient occlusion. Because here, it was faster just to do ambient occlusion and then do lighting and exposures just in Photoshop. So this export literally took like 5 minutes, instead of in Podium having it render, or you know, whatever program, having it render like for 25, 30 minutes, or you know, overnight, or you know, however long that might take. From there, I used a filter in Photoshop. This is a relatively, I guess it's not a new filter, but Google actually purchased this. It's called Nick Collections. Think of it like an Instagram filter effects for Photoshop. It's a free collection of filters, so you can do HDR effects, hue and saturation adjustments, bokeh effects, which is much, I feel like it's more of like a click and select your preset and sort of have it be done. But the beauty of this is if I just use typical Photoshop tricks like hue, saturation, levels, exposure, I'm doing that for 4 images. So I have to make sure I'm staying consistent so that all 4 images look the same way. So with SketchFX and with the Nick collections, I'm making sure I'm using the same preset on every single export. And for the Nick collections, I'm using that same saved preset. From there, it doesn't do everything, so you still need to clone and stamp some elements into the model. So you see I'm cloning and stamping some of the flora elements. And then things never look bright enough in the model. So for print, a lot of times it looks, I'm not sure how it looks up on there, but it usually looks oversaturated on my screen here. But usually when that gets printed, it looks a little bit better. So we tend to overexpose and oversaturate the color because that's kind of what everybody wants to see. And then one of the last tricks that I always do, and this is really for any architectural rendering that I do, is I need to see line work. I like renderings that still feel like renderings and aren't super polished or super photorealistic. So I'll export a hidden line layer that I could then in Photoshop add a multiply and sort of opacity setting there. And then lastly, using that green screen, just bringing in that water effect, which was basically just a Google search of water effects and just copying and pasting what one looked best there. So to wrap up, I can't thank enough Gary Radin and Sam that really just allowed me to be sort of a small part of, you know, many, many people that work on sort of the Philadelphia Flower Show every year. If you're interested, this year's Flower Show is March 2nd to the 10th in Philadelphia. The theme is Flower Power, which will be really cool. I'm working on that show right now. You can reach me if I do have some business cards left here, and then I'll open up to Q&A in a couple seconds. My email is dan@sketchuptrainer.com. And for the rest of the rest of Basecamp, I'll actually be at the VR Island with the guys from Unreal Engine from 12 to 2 this afternoon, and then also Friday. So if you have any questions about any of the stuff that I showed that I can't answer in this quick Q&A, you know, just find me as well. And I'll take any questions if you need to leave, you know, more than welcome to, but anybody else staying for questions, certainly. Yeah.
Okay, so in layout, mm-hmm. It looked like you were able to link to both SketchUp files, right?
Correct.
So is that true when you're
in SketchUp
and
Master
Model, you
can't really? You cannot unless you use an extension. So there's the... Yes, there's this one, it's called Reference Manager. It costs $50, but it will do a true link like AutoCAD would or like Layout does. The way that I typically use it instead is you can right click on any component in that master file and just replace it with or select any SketchUp file. I use it as a manual way. So I usually don't use the extension just because I didn't feel like spending the $50. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Reload, reload, reload. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. They move. Oh, yeah. So if you made changes to the SketchUp model, the point that dimension or that note was snapping on, that may have moved. So this will show up like as a red box around it. Just right click on it, and there will be an option here to reconnect. So it's not showing here because this one's already connected. Let's see if I have a page that. Oh, there you go, yep. So if I right click on that, it says reconnect to the model. So good point though is it's really annoying that it's not linked. If you don't need to touch that element, when you export out as a PDF, that red overlay doesn't show. No, it doesn't print. It's only a visual cue for you. Yep. Yep. So the other thing that I'll do too is if you have a lot, you don't want to right click on each note, just do a Control A or Command A. So even though you're selecting everything but including like viewports and whatnot, you can right click and there will still be an option here to reconnect to model. So it'll find all the unconnected ones to reconnect.
When you showed that flower library, plant library you made, were you lucky enough to find all those pictures as is, or did you have to cut out backgrounds in Photoshop?
So Gary painfully cut out probably every file.
Okay, so yeah.
No, it's really just a Photoshop magic wand and polygon wand. Yeah.
I figured, okay. Mm-hmm.